was born in Manhattan, in New York City. And shortly thereafter, my family moved to Long Island. Bayside was still part of New York City, even though it was country, the edges of Manhattan, the edges of New York City.
What did kids, you know, little kids in your age, what did you do for fun in the summers, that kind of thing? I mean,
oh, we rode bicycles, we roller skated, ice skating. I went hunting with my dad while I was growing up. Made me an NRA member early. Anyhow, but the one thing, as I had told my son, Tom, who's here with me today, that aviation interested me. I had a good friend that was his best man at his wedding. He and I used to bike all the time when we were 12, 13, 15 years old. We used to bike from Bayside to Mitchell Field and Roosevelt Field, which was, Roosevelt Field was where Lindbergh left from, and it was a famous airport. And we used to go out there and watch the airplanes taking off and landing and talking with some of the mechanics and getting into the aviation field. I was always interested from 6, 7 years old. I told my my children that I used to get a cardboard box and cut out the top of it. The front flap I used to put down with all the instruments and use my mother's broken broomstick as a joystick. At 5, 6, 7 years old, I was already in a cockpit. When I was in high school, I used to dawdle in my scrap paper on my desk while the teacher was talking. And this was when everything was radial engines. And I swear I had designed the perfect P-51. On paper, here I was like 10, 12 years old. The P-51 hadn't even been visualized yet. And that was always my dream. And when I ended up going to the Air Force, we're in the end of our high school years, and just starting into Queens College, and the war started, and I enlisted for aviation cadet.
Do you remember when Pearl Harbor was bombed?
Absolutely.
And what was your reaction to it? Remember what you thought?
I was with this good friend of mine that I told you I was his best man. He and I, was a Sunday afternoon, and we had heard it on the radio, and we couldn't believe what we were hearing.
Did you know at some point you were getting into it?
I knew. I was 18 years old. I knew I would be drafted soon, and I wanted to be in my desire of flying, so that's why I enlisted in the Aviation Cadet Corps. And it was accepted, and they said it'll be 3 or 4 months before your appointment comes up. So I figured if I'm going to be flying pilot, I want to know what my engines are doing. So I went to a federal program up in Quoddy, Maine, that was an aircraft and engines school, to go up and possibly get my A&E license for working on airplane engines, which would give me the knowledge of what my engines were doing and all that if I was going to be flying an airplane. It was like a 4-month course. And I was up there 3 months, and my mother called me on the telephone and told me that the Air Force had sent me a notice that my appointment was up, and that on a certain date, within a week or so, I had to report to, I think it was Whitehall Street in New York City, I guess you would say it was not to enlist, because I had already enlisted, but to receive my acceptance of my appointment, okay, and go. So we left, went to Tennessee, Nashville, Tennessee, for assignment. So now we were all accepted as aviation cadets, but nobody knew whether you were going to navigation school, bombardier school, or pilot school. So at Nashville was where they selected where you were going to, and we were assigned to Ryan Air Force Base, or Ryan Field at the time, flying those beautiful, I'll take that back. When we left Nashville, we were assigned to Santa Ana Primary Flight School. And I guess about 2 months or 3 months, we were assigned to class 43J. And then we graduated and went to primary flight training school, flying these Ryan PT-22s. That was my alma mater, where I learned how to fly.
Had you ever been in an airplane before you got in the service?
I had been in a steerman at Flushing Airport, where Speed Saunders used to have, this name came up after 80 years. When I was 15 or 16 years old, there was two of us in my family, my brother and myself. And he and I, the World's Fair was coming on, 1939, and Speed Saunders were selling rides for, back in those days, $10 for 20 minutes to take you over the World's Fair and show you. So my brother and I chipped in our little nickel bottles of soda and deposits and all. We weren't a rich family, but we had enough savings to be able to hire for a ride in this steerman, the two of us in the back seat strapped in. And that was my first ride.
And that's an open cockpit.
And he took us for a little longer than 10 minutes. You know, he took us around. I guess he liked youngsters being interested in flying at this age. The war hadn't come on yet. So anyhow, and this was a little past my cardboard box cockpit that I used to go up in. But I was an adamant air enthusiastic machine. So
back, you're training at the Ryans, on the Ryan.
So that was my first flight in an airplane, okay? So now I'm at Ryan Air Force Base, and we're going through my first solo I never will forget. Not solo, I'm sorry. My first, Chadwick was my instructor, Bob Chadwick. Jeez, for 84 years old, I'm surprised I can remember all this, but anyhow. So his name was Bob Chadwick. He was my flight instructor. And he says, Nick, we're going up for a quick circle. I'll show you the area of practice and the pattern for landing and all that. And I'll let you touch the controls a little bit. So being knowledgeable about aviation, I knew, you know, what the throttle and the stick and the rudder pedals and everything. So he said, you know, take over for a little bit. So I did. And I never will forget, he let me make the pattern coming in. And here we were, we made the last turn into the runway. And I'm pulling back on the stick. I figured I'm going to slow her down a little bit. But I must have pulled it just a little too far back. And it started to go over to a possible spin, you know? So, and he quickly grabbed it. And I always remembered that from that day on, you have to watch your landings. That was an education that I hadn't realized with all my practicing in cardboard boxes. I went through the rest of it with flying colors and finished my primary at Ryan Field. And then we went to Minter Field, basic flight training. Everything went well. My grades were great. We're just at the end of basic training at Minter. And I don't remember the field that we were going to be sent to, because at basic is where they decided, are you going to fighters? Are you going to troop transport? Are you going to bombers? Or where are you going? So with us little guys, they set us up, and we were, you know, sort of energetic, the type they wanted for fighter pilots. So my dream came true. I was assigned to a P-51. And it was just the last week before we were being transferred to advanced flight training. And I was leading a formation of three airplanes. And we were so happy we were going to be fighter pilots. So I led these two guys. We were going down a canyon, and then we were like youngsters who have no sense of responsibility at those days. We were going to be fighter pilots, so let's do what we're going to do when we get overseas, you know? So we were running up this mountain in California, and came up to the top of the mountain, and there was a beautiful field, a hay field, all hay, rye, barley, I don't know what it was, but it was being plowed. And the farmer was on top guiding the Mexican people that were throwing the hay on the hay wagon. And we went down practically ground level, came up to the hay wagon and just pulled the whole formation up. Boy, we did it just like we're going to do in Europe, you know. But the farmer got my number, the one that was on top of the wagon. Soon as I got back, they called me and they asked me to report to headquarters. Of course, as an officer, a planned officer ahead, you know, it was asked me if I did it. Of course, yes, sir, it was me. I led the formation, and these other boys were just following me on formation. They had nothing to do with it. It was my fault. And what reason? I said I had no excuse. That was common for officer training. You had no excuse for doing something that was wrong. So they assigned me to a check flight, but the intention was he's gone. And I guess they were putting out enough pilots. They weren't anxious like they were at the beginning, you know? So I did my check flight. Perfect. Came around, ended the check flight, coming back in for landing, my flaps down and everything else, landing in, make a beautiful touchdown. He jams the throttle forward on me and says, emergency, have to go around. So right away, you know, I alerted myself and started give the throttle. I had my hand on the throttle, give the throttle a little more power and get off. But with the suddenness of this unexpected reaction, I didn't release my flaps. So that was his excuse to wash me out. So I lost my dream of being a pilot, okay?
It must have been disappointing.
It was the greatest disappointment of my life. I was assigned to Armor Gunner School in Denver, and they shipped me out, and I became an expert on the bomb site, the Norden bomb site. Armament was my specialty. I learned in Denver because it was a headquarters for chief armorer. Just like they had a training school for chief engineer, the flight engineers that would go on a B-17, they also had the armorers that would go on a B-17, and that's what they were training me for. So I met with my crew. We formed to a B-17 crew, assigned a B-17 for training. And I think we had about 3 months or 4 months of domestic training to work like a crew.
How did the crew come together? You got all these guys from different parts of the country.
Different parts of the country.
How did your crew coalesce? How did they do?
Well, I had Sid Levine, born one day before me. The two of us thought alike. He was an intellectual. And when our crew used to go to London to play around with the girls in the bars and stuff. He and I would go up to Cambridge and see the universities. We'd go to London to see the museums. And we did our share of, you know, carousing, but most of the time we went there like as an intellectual tour.
I've got a question for you, and you might not even have an answer for it, but you know, when you get a group of guys like that together, there's the prankster, there's the ladies' man, there's the intellectual, there's the...
We had them all.
Yeah, and in that group, what would they say who you were?
I was the guy that kept the group together. Not Mr. Popularity, exactly, but I was part of the enlisted crew. And I liked every one of them that we for 3 months that we worked together, we worked together beautifully. I mean, we worked together like a real team, okay? We had a couple of emergency landings while we were training. I think one we landed on a belly. Anyhow, yeah, we did put a training B-17 on the belly one time, and we all came out, and the fire engines were there, I guess the technical personnel were there, and they grouped us together, and we took a picture of the crew. That's the picture you see in the museum here at the 390th. I went over with the whole crew from Kearney, Nebraska. That's where we went to pick up our brand new B-17. I think we stopped at Labrador for the last stop for fueling before we went all the way across. And we took this beautiful, shiny, brand new B-17, because they used to paint them camouflage, you know, all ugly looking colors. And here we were taking all a shiny B-17 over there, brand new, that we were going to use, because they told us that as shiny as it is, the gun is down on the ground, the German gun is, it would shine with the reflection of the sky and you couldn't see us, which sounded pretty fair to me, because an airplane all painted dark colors against, blended against the sky was a little bit too dark and too noticeable, you know, so.
You know, that flight over, you know, over to the UK, that's a lot of water to go over in a long journey. What do you remember about that journey?
I remember that I had heard in England they have only biscuits on the army cots that we were going to sleep in. And I was always one for comfort. So I brought my pillow from the States. And I folded my pillow and put it in my barracks bag. And I brought it on the airplane with me. And I used that, and we dozed in the cabin of the airplane. I don't remember wearing oxygen masks, but I think we were high enough to have oxygen. I'm not sure. And that part of the trip, it was a night trip. And we got there early in the morning. Just as it was dawning, we hit the coast of Wales.
Do you remember any sense of relief that your navigator had found?
Oh, no. We had the fullest confidence in him. We knew he'd put us right on the spot. We brought our airplane and landed at a special field for arriving B-17s. We didn't land at a 390th bomb base. That's where we were assigned to. But we landed our airplane there, and we lost our airplane. They put us in these army trucks with the canvas tops and took us to the 390th. I'll go back just a split second. My brother had gotten letters from me when I was an aviation cadet, and he was so pleased with what he heard about my flying, but he was in Queens College at the time and studying to be an aeronautical engineer. And he liked what he heard so much in the letters that I wrote home that he enlisted as an aviation cadet and also ended up becoming a B-24 pilot. When I was in Kearney, Nebraska, picking up our B-17 that we were assigned to, the one that we were going to have in combat, he was, I can't think of the town he was in, but I called my mother, and in Greek, I sort of had a code with her to let her understand, to tell my dad that we were getting ready to go overseas. And here it was summertime, we're going over for the D-Day invasion, from what I understand. But this was all code, because who knew who was listening on the telephone? And so I let her understand that I plan to be back by Christmas. My brother called, the same thing. He was going overseas at the same time as I was going overseas, but to the Pacific as a B-24 pilot. So we both, on both ends of the world. My father had jet black hair when I left, and when I came back in 45, the tail end of 45. Actually, it was, we came back in 44. And you have the dates.
Christmas of 44, sure. You were back.
Christmas of 44, I was back. And so my brother came back by 45. And he and I were both surprised. My father's hair was all white. From the grief. There was no television in those days. You couldn't see minute to minute of what's going on all over the world. You just had to listen to the radio like we did back in those days. And that's the only way we could get our news. And Dad would hear about, you know, the B-17s went over, like, you know, 37 B-17s were knocked down on emissions today and stuff like that. And it really worried him, and his worry caused him to have gray hair.
Did you try and stay in touch with your family with a V-mail?
I wrote letters home, but my mother saved them all, and half of them were blacked out with Scott felt depends, you know. And,
sensors?
So you learned not to write because half the letter would be all blacked out, you know. But let me finish with my brother. So my brother called home at the same week that I called, that we were getting ready for within a few days. And he called, and he was assigned nearby to pick up his B-24 to go to the Pacific. So he was an officer, and he ended up, I don't know whether he came in a Jeep or what, but we were on the traffic lane of B-17s. There was like 15 or 20 of them in front of us, taking off one every 10 or 15 minutes. And we were way back there, and this Jeep comes up alongside, and it's my brother. He came to say goodbye and see you when the war's over, Nick. So we sort of kissed goodbye and all, and he came on board and met my skipper, Phil Sheridan, and taxied all the way up till we were number one. And then the Jeep followed to pick him up at the turning point when we were getting ready to go onto the runway for takeoff. So we had about maybe half an hour or 45 minutes of last minute visit together, which was, I think, was really pleasant for him and pleasant for me. We were assigned to a dinky old camouflaged B-17, which we said we brought a shiny thing and they gave us a piece of junk. But we flew one mission, and that mission took us to the coast to soften up. There was no invasion yet. We were softening up the coastline, or maybe decoying the Germans to think that maybe they might land here when they were going to land here, you know. Whatever it was, the top people didn't tell me, but it was some kind of a ruse that we dropped bombs and all and to soften up the panzer divisions and let them think that this is where we're going to land, where we landed somewhere else, you know, St. Lo.
On that first mission, where were you located in the aircraft?
I was on the ball turret. Yeah, was it my first mission? Yeah, my first mission was in the ball turret now. I was the armor gunner, and everything was okay up above and all, and the flight engineer coordinated with me. His guns were okay, and the tail gunner was okay. Everything was all set.
What was your feeling about being in the ball? Did bother you,
hey,
you know?
18, 19 years old. You're young and stupid, man. This is an adventure. We loved it. You can't believe how many of us came back from 10, 15 missions, even with airplanes going down all around you. You come back and say, you know, when's our next flight? We're ready to go. Our next mission. Because you're too stupid to realize the danger involved, you know. You're riding motorcycles, you're riding hot rods and all before you go, so this was just another adventure. But, you know, when we got toward the end, but this first trip, we didn't get credit for it. It was a mission. So we let it pass because it was, how did they call it? Geez, there was a name they used.
Like an operational?
No, operational. a sortie. They called it a sortie. It came to me. But that's what they called this mission, a sortie. So it wasn't counted as a mission. So, all right, so to hell with it. So we didn't have a mission yet. But we still got in on the initial of the D-Day invasion. And then we went on another one in France, which we got credit for, and another one local, I think somewhere in Holland or somewhere. And the next mission was a DP, deep penetration. Okay, we were going in to Germany. And here we are, we take off in the dark, shooting flares to get the group all together. So our flares were two, like a red and a white, or a red and a green, whatever it was. I don't remember what the captain was shooting out of the ceiling, a very pistol. But we got the whole group together in formation, and about the time the sun was just starting to come daylight. And then we headed and turned toward Europe. We didn't even get over Holland yet. We just had crossed the Zuider Zee, that end of Holland and Belgium there, where it's just on the edge of the channel. And I guess on the radios, pull it in together tight. 390th was known for tight formations. That's why we didn't lose as many. We lost a lot of airplanes, but we didn't lose as many as some of the bomb groups. And from some technician we were talking to yesterday said that some of these groups that lost and had such heavy losses were because their flying was so sloppy that their formations were not tight and the fighters would come in between, easy pickings. And for us, that was up real tight. We were not easy pickings, and they left us more or less alone. The thing we had to worry about most was the flak.
Well, take us through. You just hit Holland.
Okay, I'll get back to that, yeah. We hit the Holland coast, and we're pulling in and hitting tight. In the meantime, there's some prop blast and some wind coming off the, whether it was coming down from the channel and causing turbulence and all, and we're doing this and that. And we're flying in this, our group, I guess three, and we were in the lower left group, I believe, on the outside. And the leader of our three wing hit either a gust or prop blast from the airplanes in front, whatever it was, it caused him to go up. And of course, I'm watching this. In the meantime, I hadn't been in the bombardier compartment yet. That's a different story.
You're still on the ball.
I'm still, no, oh. No. After my first mission, I was in the waist as a head armorer watching all the guns
so
and everything.
You're in the waist watching this.
I'm on the right waist window, and this airplane is almost under our wing, while the other one was right up, you know, close in front of our nose. But we were enough to the left that we didn't get affected by him. But the one on our right wing, he got hit, went up, and started to come down. And this one got hit and came up. And the two airplanes collided, one almost exactly on top of the other. The propellers of the bottom airplane cut into the wing tanks and cut the gasoline and sprinkled all over the lower airplane. Big, huge orange flames from the exhaust that lit up all the gasoline. The propeller on the top airplane, on the number one engine, the propeller started slowing down and spinning and broke off. It was like slow motion. We watched this propeller slide over the wing and fall overboard and down. And here was this airplane with only three engines left. They weren't turning. They were now by now stopped. And the two B-17s were doing this and starting to pull away from us. There was another formation here, but they dived down and got away from us, and then they separated. We saw three parachutes from the upper airplane, and watched the lower one go all the way as far as we could see. I don't know whether there was an overcast, but we didn't see anybody bail out of that lower airplane. There went 10, and only three that we could see from the upper airplane. And the upper airplane blew up. As soon as these guys jumped out, one blew up, and the other one kept going down. And
when you saw those two aircraft going down, do you remember what your sense of things were?
I mean, yeah, here's our first blood. I mean, this is the first time we ever realized we're at war. Here we just lost 20 of our best friends, maybe 17. But here, these are guys that, you know, we had breakfast with. And it was heartbreaking.
Did you keep a log?
I kept a log. I used to write home often, and just like my friend Sid, we kept in touch with our families, and as I said, I used to send home mail, but my letters I got was that half of your letter was blacked out and all, so I ended up not saying anything on my letters except that we're doing fine and stuff like that, you know? But I had a nice clipboard that I had brought with me overseas, and on the back I had glued on a log, so I ended up listing my airplane number, the date, where we were going, and how many guns were at the target, how much bombs we carried, and how long, you know, the hours. And I also have a column, because it wasn't exactly legitimate, but when the skipper got me in training from the United States, he knew my history, that I had gone almost all the way to advanced training and had been trained for P-51s and all that. And he said, you are our backup. If anything happens to the crew and we get a shell in the cockpit, you're going to bring us back. So all during training, we'd get up there and fly over the desert for 3 or 4 hours. He let me get an hour and a half, 2 hours of time, adding into my logbook. So I listed I called it stick time, and he let me fly instruments and everything else, different things that I learned all about flying a B-17. So I was qualified to fly a B-17, even though I wasn't legally a B-17 pilot, okay? But the important part was that when we went on the third mission, our bombardier couldn't stand, you know, the first two missions that were local missions wasn't too heavy, flak and all, and they were considered milk runs, okay? This was the first mission with blood spilled that we saw, and our bombardier quit. A fantastic bombardier, I mean, sharp when we were in training, he used to be able to put it right on a dot. But he said the stress for being up there in that cockpit with that big glass nose, he says, I can't take it.
What was your reaction when you learned that? Was that
we were disappointed, but I was thinking we were going to get another bombardier from the States shipped in, probably fly with a temporary bombardier, you know, that was flying with other crews, and then maybe he needed an extra mission, and they would fly until they arranged something. But the skipper came to me, and he said, Nick, you are our candidate. We voted among the crew, and you are the candidate to go up to the bombardier's compartment and be our bombardier. He says, because you know all about the armaments, you're fully recognizing all the ins and outs of the Norden bomb site. He says, you know how to work and everything else. And you could be up there with your pilot time, that if anything happens to us, you could just jump right up from the bombardier seat right up to the cockpit and relieve us if something should happen. He says, he even wanted to give me a field commission. I was a staff sergeant at the time. You know, when you're a graduate when I went to armor gunner school, I became a sergeant. And then when I graduated and became a full-time armament engineer, then I was a staff sergeant. No, I guess we were staff when we were assigned to a crew. You were given a lower stripe. And he wanted me to be an officer. I said to him, Phil, I like my enlisted men. And we go to the NCO club and we have some good times. And I said, you've been nice enough to invite us to the officers club. And it's so dull and boring there. I said, we have fantastic times at the NCO club. I said, you don't mind, I'd rather stay an enlisted man and be with my crew. Stupid at that time, because if I had been an officer, things might have been different, you know.
How many missions did you fly total?
I flew 30 missions.
And just so I've got a sense, can you? I'm pretty amazed by the. I mean, you were in the ball turret, in the waist gun position,
and then moved up to the bombardier position.
And you knew how to fly a B-17. can you give us a sense of how many of those missions were in each of those three positions? How many times were you in the ball once?
Or? I was the first mission. I was in the ball turret, and then I flew about two or three missions in the waist. That's when our bombardier quit, and that's when my skipper asked if I would like to move up to the bombardier position.
You know, of those 30 missions, you've certainly described some very memorable missions, and you're not going to remember all 30 missions, but were there other missions that come to mind for one reason or another?
One, I got hit on a Warsaw-Poland mission in the leg with flak when I was in the bombardier's position. And being over Poland, we helped the Polish underground, and there's another Polish Home Army. The two of them awarded us two Polish Crosses of Honor. Each organization awarded my crew a Polish Cross of Honor from the war, the Poland government, and from the underground. Okay, and. I was awarded that Polish Cross in Dayton, Ohio, at a gathering where the Polish government sent representatives to present Dayton with a stone for the 390th. I guess you would say they were complimenting us on that mission that we flew to Poland to drop supplies, medical ammunition and guns in an area that had been stripped with sheets and demarked where the target was. Now, the Germans said only 2% of the canisters landed within the area, but the Polish general said 89% of all those canisters reached those people. This is one of the memorable missions I'm talking about.
Where did you land in that mission?
We landed at Poltava in Russia. Now, it was a mission that had parachutes on these canisters. So we couldn't go to our usual 29, 30,000 feet because the parachutes would open and they would drift way off target. So we came down to 14,000 feet, and I think the parachutes were rigged to open at about 1,000 feet or something like that, that close to the ground. And we saw most of the parachutes landing within that area. I don't know. Anyhow, but as soon as we dropped the bombs, boom, on the right side of us, a flak explosion, and some of the flak came through and hit me in the right leg. Not all the way to the bone or anything, but, you know, I stopped the bleeding and everything and bandaged it up. We weren't at that high an altitude where we needed oxygen masks and we didn't need, heating equipment and all. So from the target, the skipper followed the formation, which the whole formation dipped down to ground level and continued over Russia to Poltava, where we were going to land. And they were expecting us there. We lost one airplane at the target. And that's in the Blue Book, too. I can't remember offhand the name of the airplane that went down. But the rest of us managed to squirm through the high-powered flak that was coming up from the German side and the guns flashing on the Russian side. They're supposed to be our allies. And the guns were all flashing on that side, too, because they didn't want us to free the Poles, who were freedom fighters. They wanted communists, and they were not communist people, the Warsaw people. So he was right across, the Russians were right across the river. They could help them, but they refused to help them. That's why we flew all the way from England, but it was a long-haul mission that we didn't have enough fuel to get back. That's why we had to land in Poltava. On the way from Warsaw, where the target was, to Poltava, and this is not written anywhere, you won't find it in the annals, but we lost three airplanes to the Russians, three B-17s, knocked down. Moller, Pennybaker, our commanders, screamed, how could they do this, you know, and all that. And the apologies came back and forth, you know, it was a mistake and all. But it's too late. There's nothing we could do about it, okay? We lost four airplanes on that mission. Three of them were to the Russians. We were so low to the ground, you could see them with the pistols and the rifles and all firing at us. And we were warned not to fire back while we were flying over Russia. So there was we couldn't protect ourselves. But at the same time, they were like as if we were the enemy, you know? So we ended up finishing that. And years later, I got an invitation to go to Dayton, Ohio, where they were going to award the graveyard, I call it, where all these monuments are for the Flying Tigers and everybody else. The 390th was going to get this memorial stone from Poland with engraved to the 390th Bomb Group, the brave souls and all that, you know. And they presented each of us that was alive and made that reunion, if you want to call it that. They awarded us the two crosses, the Polish crosses. And I had never received my Purple Heart, you know, for that mission. That didn't come for 50 years after I came out of the service. The same as my Distinguished Flying Cross. I had received a Distinguished Flying Cross at the end of my missions, but because I was taken off flight status for that 1 or 2 days and I missed my mission with my crew, when they had 30 missions, I only had 29. Well,
Take you back, because we're skipping a little bit. You landed in Poltava, you're injured, all right?
Yeah.
What happened after that?
I could walk off the airplane, and the medical staff took care of me nice. They bandaged me up and all that, and I'm limping a little bit.
Did you want to keep flying?
Yeah, I want to stay with my crew. I'm not going to stay in Russia. So we had another mission from Russia to... Oh, my gosh. I should have brought my log. It was in Albania, or one of those...
Romania?
Romania, Albania, one of those towns that we left Russia all tanked up with bombs and everything else, refueled, ammunition and everything else. And we flew over this target and landed in Foggia, Italy. That was counted as a mission. And from Foggia, Italy, we flew back empty. It wasn't a mission, it was a return to base. So when we got back to base, the flight surgeon said, we're taking you off flight status. I said, why? I flew two trips the way I am. I can make my next trip with my crew. No way. Some kind of ruling with the medical staff that you had to be off for at least 48 hours or something. And it forced me to miss my trip, my next mission with my crew.
And why is that bad?
That was bad because when they finished with 30 missions, they all got their Distinguished Flying Crosses before they went back. We all had our four air medals. during the middle of our missions. But the Distinguished Flying Cross, I never got it before I went back. And the skipper told me, you know, I put you in for the Purple Heart, so don't worry about it, you'll get it. So I didn't think anything about it. As I say, I wasn't over there for medals. We were over there to do a job and get it over with and come back home. So came back home, and I was a B-24 instructor in armament. I was on a B-17 for a whole year, and suddenly I come back and I'm on a B-24. So that's returning back.
Let me ask you one question. When you landed in Russia, did you have any interaction with the Russians?
Oh, very, very nice people. The peasants were absolutely wonderful. I mean, they had food ready for us, a regular tents with a food line, you know, for us. And, oh, fantastic cooking. I mean, the Russians cook pretty good. And the people were so, what a difference to the troops that were shooting at us on the way in. You know, we thought we'd meet the same kind of resistance on the ground. But they were entirely the opposite. They were so friendly and so nice to us.
Would they try and communicate with you?
A little. You know, we had learned a couple of Russian words. We were taught a couple of Russian words, like, you know, like, don't shoot, I'm American, and all this stuff. But we understood each other like a sign language. You know, you go to a foreign country, we understood each other enough that they were trying to make our landing pleasant and our food pleasant. And then we slept. We left one on guard with our airplane. Each one of us in the airplanes left one person on guard so nobody would enter the airplanes. And I think it was broken up like, 3 hours each. I didn't have to do any duty because I was walking around with the bandages.
When you landed in Foggia, Italy, did you get a chance to look around a little bit there?
Oh, we went to town and everything. We landed on metal strips with the holes in them, you know. And the whole airport in Foggia was a, I guess, a fighter base. But the B-17s with those big tires could land on these metal strips, and it was our landing area. And we stayed there, I guess about 2 days, resting up.
What did it look like?
Italy was, I wouldn't say Italy was spotless. You would go to the town, and the bathrooms had two platforms where you put your 2 feet, one on each, and the trough where the urine ran down, you know? But that was, compared to England, it was a lot different. In England, everything was, you know, sort of high class. But the people were nice. And, you know, the troops had moved up as far as Foggia already. And I guess most of the Italians were happy that they got the Germans out. And a lot of them were not pro-Mussolini. So they were glad to see the Americans. We had some fairly nice experiences. We loaded the airplane with cases of Coca-Cola because the old waste bottle of Coca-Cola, the old-fashioned ones, they had all you could buy at the PX, you know? It's like, what, a nickel a bottle or something? So we put about 10 of them in our waste area where the radio operator was and strapped them down to bring back to our barracks that we're going to have good old-fashioned American Coca-Cola, which we couldn't get in England. And so we had gotten up to altitude, and pretty soon, pop, 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 the Coca-Colas were bursting all over the place. I never realized that, and none of the crew realized it. So we lost about 90% of our Coca-Colas. Either you drink it now, we didn't go very high on the return trip, so it wasn't to where it was 75 degrees below zero up there, you know, like on a mission. I guess the temperature was in the 20s or something, but enough to sort of freeze the Coca-Colas and pop the caps off. So we did rescue some of the Cokes and brought them to the barracks. But we had to do the cleaning of the airplane. You know, when Coca-Cola is shaken and it pops out, this was the same thing with the foam all over the floors and everything, dirtying our B-17.
You got back to England on that mission. You were injured.
I was injured, and I got back to England, and the flight surgeon says, you're grounded. I said, why? I've flown two missions since I got hit. Why should I be grounded? I says, I don't have to do any standing or walking around on the airplanes. I'm a bombardier. I sit at the bombardier's panel. He says, we can't fight regulations. So they took me off the trip. So now, the next trip I'm on, my crew has like I don't remember, what was it, 20 trips, 18 missions or whatever, and I was one behind them. So when they got to 30 missions, their last mission, I flew with them, I was on my 29th mission. A stretch of time passed before I got taken off my crew and assigned to another crew to fly my last mission. Well, that period of time, they were changing the number of missions that you would fly. Instead of 30 missions now, it was getting so easy in the sky with the Messerschmitts and the Focke-Wulfs not coming up as often that now you had to fly 35 missions. So they were saying I had to fly 35 missions. I said, why? I said, it was a flight surgeon's decision that I should come off my flight, that I couldn't fly my last mission with my crew. So it extended me another week until you wanted to change the regulations on my flying. And I said, it wasn't my fault. So anyhow, they didn't give me the Purple Heart. At that time, and because I finished late past my crew, who all got their DFCs, I didn't get the DFC either.
Did you only have to fly that one more mission, though?
That's all.
Okay.
I had one more to go.
And do you remember who the crew was you had to fly with, what that mission was like?
I have their names down somewhere.
But do you remember the experience of having to fly with another crew? Any strange feelings about it?
Well, you know, I figured here we were on a crew that didn't have a scratch, except maybe if I didn't forgive God for washing me out from pilot training and kind of lost my religion belief. He warned me by hitting me in the leg and saying, hey, we put you here, we're taking care of you, but don't lose your religion anymore. So I had some philosophy of religion that God was good to me. You know, I mean, things were working out even though I didn't get my desired position that I really wanted so bad.
Was that last mission a milk run? Pretty, you know, what happened?
The last mission was Merseburg. I don't have to tell you.
And well, I'm fine with you. Tell us your story of the Merseburg mission.
Well, it was kind of dim memory because it was something I didn't want to be on. I didn't want to be with a strange crew. I figured, what fate am I, you know, like my whole crew got back safely and I'm assigned to this crew. What is the plans for me from up above, you know? And so it worried me. I thought maybe this was in the book, planned for me to go. But
what position on the aircraft did you have on that flight? Bombardier?
I think I was bombardier. Well, it was called the Togglier. Mm. It wasn't really called bombardier.
So you're in the nose.
So if my skipper would have given me the field commission that he wanted, it would have been considered a bombardier because I had the same training that our bombardier had, and the two of us worked together pretty good. And he trained me on a lot of things from the officer's standpoint. So I knew all that.
Tell us your story of what you remember about this Merseburg mission. What happened?
We got hit with fighters. We got hit with flak. It was not an easy mission, okay? And I was sincerely relieved when we got back, because I figured there's got to be a reason why I'm taken off with my crew and put on a brand new crew. And they were brand new, if I'm not mistaken. I think this was their second or third mission. But I came through it safely. Now, if I'll regress back, one other mission beside the Warsaw mission and the Merseburg mission that at the end, one other mission that stood out in my mind was flying over Germany, and I don't know whether it was Stuttgart or where, I can't remember offhand where that was, where our bombs hung up in the bomb bay. We had 3,000-pounders on each side. And the right side salvoed out okay from my bombardier's position, and the left side salvoed only the bottom bomb. The second bomb hung up for what reason? Because everything was just the way it should be. The second bomb hung up and the top bomb fell onto it, okay? With a big clunk, you could hear it throughout the whole airplane. And the skipper says, we already had been over the target and left the target now. The skipper says, Nick, we got a problem in the bomb bay. I says, I know, I heard it. And he says, go back and take a look. So I take my oxygen, portable oxygen mask, and I open the bomb bay doors, and there's two bombs, one loose on top, and the other one hung up. I tried with a screwdriver, with my oxygen. Now we're still up around 30,000 feet. Temperature outside, about 70 below zero. I got my heated gloves on and my suit plugged in, you know, to keep me warm and all that. When I review the situation, the bomb bay doors are wide open now because I told the skipper, we got one bomb loose in the bomb bay resting on top of a 500-pounder that's hung up, a 1,000-pounder that's hung up. So he says, well, you're the bombardier, you're the armored gunner, do something about it. So I'm trying to use the oxygen mask. You know how long you can hold your breath up there. You can't hold it up for very long. But I couldn't get between the bombs and the bulkhead with all that oxygen equipment, my armament suit and everything else. So I had to take everything basically off. My oxygen mask, I left the tank on the catwalk, and I'm trying to squeeze in between the bombs and the bulkhead, straddling 27,000 feet below me, an open bomb bay. Now, somebody said they saw this on Memphis Belle or 12 o'clock high or something, and I swear this happened to me, okay? Now, I don't know if they got it with imagination or whether they heard my story or what, but this was my experience. I'm straddled across the bomb bay, which is just about got you almost wide open because you know how wide a bomb bay is. And I'm standing there, and because the top bomb had pulled out of the shackle and slammed into the middle bomb, the propeller in the front was loose. And this air coming in underneath the bomb bay was turning the propeller. And I thought, oh, Jesus, you know, I'm not going to touch it.
Because that arms the bomb.
Yeah. The minute you pull the wire out of the propeller and the propeller starts turning, I never really talked to my bombardier after that, but he would know exactly how many turns. I think it was 37 turns before the pin would snap that propeller off and the pin would come out. Now all you got to do is just touch that pin and a bomb blows up, okay? So while I'm busy trying to figure out how to get this bomb out, suck on the oxygen a little bit and put it down now without an oxygen mask, straddling this open pit, I'm trying to think the exact clarity of this. The propeller pops off, and it pops off into my hand. I catch it, and I put it inside my suit. Now it's armed. Now I can't even get out of this straddling position for fear of one of my wires, one of my hangers, one of my suits, something touching that. And we blown to smithereens, the whole bunch of us, with 2,000 pounds of bombs. So while I'm trying to reach around with a screwdriver and trying to release the shackle on the middle bomb and all this, suddenly, and I'm holding on with one hand, fortunately, like on the aluminum gridwork, suddenly, in slow motion, one bomb and the other bomb go out. The suction that caused in that bomb bay while I was there almost sucked me forward to pull me overboard. Now, I had no parachute on, nothing. I had nothing on because I couldn't get in between with the distance between us in that bulkhead. But I was so relieved. But I was half conscious when this happened. And I'm trying to climb up to the catwalk, and our radio man, when the bombs went out, felt the airplane go up like this. He opened the radio door, and he saw me, and he came across the catwalk and basically saved my life because I wasn't connected to anything. So I was going to go overboard any minute. The catwalk didn't have rails, cables and all. None of that was hooked up. I think there was cables across, but they were not. In combat, we didn't have that. Not that we didn't have it, but we didn't chain across that opening. So he came across, and he right away, he had a, I guess maybe my oxygen bottle ran out, and he had another oxygen bottle. He came in and put an oxygen mask over me, and I recovered enough. And he said something about, "You did good, Nick. This is my
the radio.
My good friend, my Jewish boy friend, Sid Levine, who saved my life." When I came home from overseas, my mother would tell me about how tough it was, that they could only get meat at the meat market twice a week, and my father was only allowed 10 gallons of gasoline a month or something, you know, the rationing. And I said, "Mom, you have no idea what rationing is." I said, "These people in England, they don't even have meat. They use sawdust with maybe a little bit of Spam chopped up in it, and that's hamburger." Because the first day I went to town on my first pass to London, I went to a Woolworths, which I thought was like our Woolworths in New York. And I ordered a chocolate milkshake and a hamburger. And they laughed because they said, "We don't have ice cream for years, and there's no such thing as a hamburger." But she said, "What we have is, you know, partially sawdust and stuff." So anyhow, but the realization hit me. That was our first pass, and it hit me how these people are hurting. And I told my mother that when I got back. I said, "You know, you have no idea what rationing is like." I said, "You think you have it bad here? You should be in England." I felt sorry for those people.
Did you have opportunity for passes, get into London, that kind of thing, then?
We would fly. Just after my career with the airline, with the Air Force, I ended up working for an airline.
Well,
the passes on the Air Force were very similar to the passes that I would get on the airline. You know, I was a crew member. And we would fly a trip on the airline 2 days and then have 3 days or 4 days off. And it was the same way with flying in the Air Force. You would fly a mission, and then you would have 2 or 3 days off.
What would you do in London?
We would go to London and see the Queen's Castle, see the British troops, and you know all the traditional things you heard about England. And that's why I say with Sid Levine, my good friend, who passed away last year, regrettably, and he and I would go and take these tours, museum tours. We would take castle tours. Uh, uh, we would
we would do a thorough, and then even go to places like Cambridge and stuff like that, you know. So we did get to see a lot of the history of England, where some of my friends were deep down in the dregs of low society, where the two-waist gunners were really unbelievable. There were chasers from the word go and drinkers from the word go. So, but anyhow, but
did you ever get down into the subway, the underground?
Yeah.
What was it like down there?
Clean and spotless, and whenever a siren went off, this is where all the people went. They would go down to the other underground, and that was their air raid shelters. And a lot of them lived down there practically, you know?
Did you ever hear any V-1 rockets or see any?
Oh, we were in a hotel in London one day, living on the third floor of the hotel, and a V-2, you could hear that buzz of the engine. And when that engine quit, you knew it was coming down. Well, we were basically in bed, half asleep. So I didn't hear the buzz, but I felt the shaking of the whole building, and the hotel got hit, and the top three floors got blown off. And we were down like two or three flights below that. So we didn't have any plaster falling down or anything, but the building did shake. And I guess eventually we had to evacuate the building. You know, we had to, I guess, check out early or whatever. I don't remember the details on it. But we did have to leave because the hotel had gotten almost a direct hit on the roof.
Did you ever have to use the guns on any of your missions?
Oh, on the Warsaw mission. Just before I got hit with the flak, bombs away, a Messerschmitt is coming right at us head on. And I'm full blast, pulling the triggers and holding them down. And with the tracers, I know it's going into him. And he's coming at us, and he just went right under us. And on the mic, I said to our tail gunner, "Homer, you got one coming out from under your tail." And so he got him. So we eliminated a Messerschmitt on that mission, too.
Did you ever have any missions where you lost an engine?
Yes. We had one burst of flak that hit the right wing, making a hole approximately the size of a dining room table, and lost an engine on the side, the right side. The skipper said, "We're going to try and make it back on three engines, if we can." And we were passing by, I guess it was down Stuttgart, Merseburg, one of those missions. And the other, number four engine was blown out. And number three was hedging whether it was going to quit or not, you know. So he said, "We're passing by Switzerland right now. I'm going to take a vote among the crew and see if how many of us are interested in going into Switzerland and be interned there." I think we were around 23rd mission. We only had like about six or seven to go. And he said, if you all vote for it, we'll divert and land emergency landing in Switzerland and be interned there for the rest of the war, no matter how long the war lasts." And we all voted, absolutely, no, we don't want to be interned. We'll take our chances and go back. So we had to dump 50 caliber machine guns off board. Even over the channel, we had to take the ball turret and dump it.
You dropped the ball turret into the North Sea?
Into the North Sea, yeah. Yeah, like we were saying with my son, God only knows how many things like that, how many guns are in the channel, how many ball turrets are there. But being that it was gotten to the point where we were only on two engines, finally, And he says, I don't know how long the gasoline is going to last, but he says, we're going to try. We kept falling behind. And if we didn't get hit by any fighters, we might be able to make it back. But he says it's going to be crucial. We came over the channel, and that's where we let the ball turret go, because the fuel needles were registering. I guess he had the tanks switched over to all on the left side and all, but we were running on fumes. And we touched down, and I can't remember the name of this emergency field, but you know when you see the white clover, cliffs of Dover? Right after that, and I guess maybe the White Cliffs of Dover was supposed to be the signal of the lighting up the area where you were supposed to crash land, okay? Our gear came down. Even though we got hit in the wing and broke the wing, it didn't affect our hydraulic system. Our landing gear came down the last minute because he didn't want to have anything slow us down. So as we came past the White Cliffs of Dover, we just barely cleared it, and there was a asphalt area, a big circle, about a mile and a half or 2 miles, all asphalted. So no matter where you came from with an emergency, you could crash land there. You wouldn't block a runway or nothing. It was an emergency field for people that came back critically wounded or damaged. And we landed there. As soon as the wheels touched, the two propellers stopped. We had no more fuel left, believe it or not. It was that close, okay? But we made it back.
How did you get home? Did you fly, take a ship?
No, my crew went ahead of me. And they left for debarkation station. And about 10 days later, I finished my mission, my last mission, and I was anxious to go. And I wasn't looking for any awarding of medals or anything. I really didn't think about that. You know, as I say, we weren't there for the medals. But I ended up at a debarkation point. I had my 45 that was issued to me. All that stuff. And at the debarkation point, the sergeants that were in charge would come to all the rooms and say, any contraband you've got, dump it into the hallway, because if you get caught getting on the ship, they'll put you back and you'll stay here. You won't get back to the States and all, and scare us. And there was a lot of souvenirs, you know, when we went to Italy. And like jerks, I threw my 45 out. Others threw their Italian Berettas, all out in the hallway. I guess those guys that cleaned the hallways up must have made packages and sent them home, because we were stupid enough to believe what they were telling us, so we wanted to get home. We didn't want to lose our return back to the States, so we dumped all our contraband, as you call it, over to the hallway. The hallway was packed, you can't believe. You know, some guys had an extra A2 jacket, and they threw that out because they were only allowed one, and all these different things that came up.
What do you remember about that journey? Were there a lot of guys on that ship, or?
It was poker playing and to pass the time. We didn't play poker, you know. The guys I was on were more or less strangers, because my crew had gone on an earlier ship. So I was really alone. I'm sociable enough that I was talking with the guys and everything, but there was nobody that I was close to. And I didn't play poker, you know. Anyhow, we get back to Atlantic City. And assignment. And that's when I was assigned to a B-24 group to train these new B-24 gunners that were going overseas. The war hadn't finished yet.
Do you remember about when you got back?
It was roughly, I got back for Christmas.
44, then.
Yeah. I told my mom and dad I was getting back for Christmas, and I kept my promise. I didn't know how I could control the missions and everything, but somehow I just told them I'll be back for Christmas. Maybe not to worry them or whatever, but it happened that I did get back for Christmas, and they were overjoyed that I made it. My brother didn't get back until a few months later. He was in the Pacific.
They put you in B-24s then?
Yeah. And it was strange to me, but the armament was similar to exactly what I was used to. So the ball turret was very similar. The 50 calibers were exactly the same and all. You know, so basically, the airplane itself may have been different, but what I was there to train them on was similar to what was on a B-17. So I stayed there for a while, and I don't know whether I put in for it or whether I was assigned it, but I went to Okmulgee, Oklahoma. And it was a return point. I guess the war was finishing. By the time I came home in December and had my month's leave, and then in March or April when I was leaving to go to Texas, to Brownsville, Texas, where the B-24 base was that I was going to be teaching at, the war had finished in Europe, and they were starting to send the B-17s back, and Okmulgee, Oklahoma was a base that had hundreds of acres of bare land around this airport, and that's where they were parking all these B-17s that were coming back, one after the other. I kept looking for our number, but...
Well, let me ask you, how long did you stay in the service then?
3 years, 4 months, 22 days.
Well, let me ask you what I think is probably the most important question, and that is, that's your jacket behind you there. Does it still fit?
No. I passed it down to my number one son, who I lost last year to terminal cancer, a really quick-acting cancer. And he passed it down to my number two son. I have 7 sons altogether. And number two son used it for a while because I taught him how to fly, and he's a pilot with a commercial instrument license and an instrument rating and a commercial pilot's license. And then he finally passed it down to number six son. And number six son has taken this jacket and maintained it so that it still looks like it's in the good shape that it was in when I first came back from the service. I can't fit into it, but at least they're carrying on the tradition of wearing my shirt.
You sure the jacket?
My jacket.
Are you sure the jacket didn't shrink?
No, I expanded. Now, I went with my wife from New York. Usually, I'll fly to a reunion like this. This is too far to drive. But Dayton, Ohio is not far from New York. And I said to my wife, why don't you come? She always thinks it's a bunch of Boy Scouts that we get together and shoot the bull and all this. And she's not interested. Well, this particular reunion that was in Dayton, Ohio, the Poles had come over the day before, and headquarters had quarters for us in the base hotel to stay at the same base hotel. So when we arrived with my car, we had the gate pass to get through the gate. We went inside, and they told us where to go to the hotel and everything. And in the lobby of the hotel are all these people. Now, I'm not going to say peasants, because they weren't peasants. They were well-dressed. They looked like American people, but they talked with a Polish accent. And they were mature people now that were teenagers in Warsaw, Poland, where we had dropped the bombs. So while I was checking in, my wife sat and was talking with them, and I guess they knew that we had come for the awards, the Polish awards. And so they were talking to my wife, kissing her hand and crying and saying how thankful they were for that mission that we pulled, you know, and got my wife to the point where she was so emotional, she was crying with them. And she said to me on the way home that we drove about 10 hours back home, she said to me, I never realized how thankful these people were for that one particular mission, she says, and I realized that, you know, your wartime service is not just a piece of cake or a joyride, you know, that you, I always thought you guys had. Because she was younger than me, and when the war was over, she was just in her teens, you know. So she never realized.
You know, when you look back at your time in World War II, are you proud of your time in service?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, I ended up with 29 decorations. I have my framework at home. My wife says there's no room in our house to hang it up. So it's sitting behind an armchair somewhere, you know. But I have a glass frame with all my medals and everything.
Tell me why you personally feel, why are you proud of your time in service?
Because I felt that we had a job to do, and we went over there and did it.